Good morning, please take your seat.
Un istante.
Distinguished authorities, admirals, generals, fellow COE directors, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to everyone. Buongiorno e benvenuti a Vicenza. As your host, I would like to welcome you to the 2021 NATO Center of Excellence Directors Conference, which this year takes place in this beautiful town, hosted by Confindustria, the General Confederation of the Italian Industry, in this fabulous building. As you can admire, look at the ceiling, for instance. First and foremost, I would like to thank Senator Stefania Pucciarelli and the Secretary of State of the Italian Minister of Defense for honoring us with their presence, which underlines the importance Center of Excellence have for Italy and the importance they do play for the Alliance as a whole. Then, although unfortunately is not present due to the still ongoing pandemic, my heartfelt gratitude goes to the Deputy Supreme Allied Commander Transformation, DSACT, General Paolo Ruggero, the Center of Excellence Superfuoco Champion. Since he assumed his duty as DSACT, General Ruggero has indeed been championing for us, dear fellow directors, making his utmost best to include our high-level expertise in NATO, in NATO never-ending transformation process. Transformation is key. His presence will surely reinforce COE ACT bounds, tasks which Major General Guglielmo Cavo, ACT Deputy Chief of Staff Joint Force Development, who will indeed be standing on his behalf, will certainly accomplish. Thank you for your presence as well, and thanks to Colonel Pacillo, the branch head of the relevant action officers. I would also like to thank the Italian authorities in attendance, starting from Sua Eccellenza, the prefect of the province of Vicenza, Dr. Pietro Signoriello, grazie Eccellenza. Then Lieutenant General Antonio Paparella, Carabinieri Northeast Interregional Commander, who is attending the conference on behalf of the commander of the Carabinieri, General Teo Luzzi. Then to Brigadier General Spina, Legion Commander of the Carabinieri, to General Barbano, Director of the Center of Excellence for Stability Police Unit here in Vicenza. And then the Mayor of this beautiful city, Avvocato Francesco Rucco, beg your pardon. Grazie tantissimo per la sua ospitalità. Last but not least, I take this opportunity to express my deepest gratitude to the President of Confindustria in Vicenza, Mrs. Laura Della Vecchia, without whom all of this would not be possible. She is hosting this event, and we have to thank her for her availability. Now that I welcome everyone, I would like to move on and discuss about the event itself, which is indeed a unique opportunity for the COE's directors to get together with colleagues in ACT and discuss matters of mutual interest for improving cooperation and making the work of COEs more and more innovative and efficient. Innovation is the bread and butter of the COEs. In the concept note of this event, which I drafted and circulated some time ago, highlighted the work undergone by British naturalist Charles Darwin in developing his natural selection theory, by which species that successfully adapted or evolved to meet the changing requirement of their natural habitat thrived and reproduced, whilst those which failed to evolve and reproduce died off. The recent past presents us with several examples of failures led by lack of innovation. I do not want to wish to name and shame famous and important companies which lost a key market because of the failure to evolve. But one example comes to mind. Those of you who are not that young anymore might remember when the first smartphone arrived on the market. At that time, a famous company was almost single-handedly leading the market of mobile phones. In just a couple of months, the company was out of business. The CEO of this great company delivered a famous speech when the latter was eventually taken over by another big company. In this speech, he stated, we didn't do anything wrong, but somehow we lost. Can the alliance afford to lose? The reality, according to me, is far from true. The company failed to innovate. The Mita is no exception. NATO does not, in fact, exist in a vacuum. But it is an important regional organization in a globalized world that requires all its players to operate at the highest level of efficiency to remain competitive. The consequences, as Charles Darwin mentioned, are extinction. Clearly, innovation is at the core of the alliance. And as General Ruggero says, when he reminds us to keep in mind the importance of the NATO War Fighting Capstone Concept, NWCC is the acronym which we have to keep in mind. This is self-explanatory. The future success of NATO depends on the ability of the Allies to continue to transform to meet tomorrow's challenges, being proactive and anticipatory in the way NATO prepares for tomorrow in order to maintain its military advantage. In fact, by virtue of the great expertise available, NATO centers of excellence represent another great opportunity for NATO to innovate, being them high-level, knowledgeable repositories. In this regard, the relationship between NATO COEs and the Alliance is symbiotic. Both mutually benefit from each other and need to develop hand in hand, ultimately for the benefit of the Alliance. This is the reason that led me to propose a SWOT analysis on the effectiveness of COEs vis-à-vis the Alliance, where SWOT stands for strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threat. By involving all COEs directors, young disruptors from the Atlantic Forum and the University of Padova, and our colleagues from ACT-CPD branch led by Francesco, we will compile a document which we will eventually deliver to ACT in order to make the contribution of the COEs even more effective and efficient. Moreover, last year I've also presented a new initiative that I've been working on for the past year, which is to create a COE director network. The reason behind the network is the possibility for the COE's directors to interact more frequently and aside the formal boundaries in order to exchange views on the day-to-day administration of NATO COEs. More specifically, the COE Directors Network, which operates in parallel to the formal structures established by NATO and to which participation occurs on a strictly voluntary basis, will cover the following work strands: promoting the role of NATO COEs throughout the Alliance and beyond, fostering interaction, networking, and unclassified information sharing, as well as developing partnership in order to exchange best practices, comparing experiences, ensuring a holistic approach, unity of effort, and peer-to-peer support. Collaborate on future COE-related policies, guidelines, standard operating procedures, and manuals. Assessing the use of new technologies for capacity development activities, improving common relevant strategies and procedures. So far, 19 out of 28 COE directors have expressed their willingness to participate to the COE Directors Network. And I'm confident by the end of this COE Directors Conference, others will follow, as we have seen yesterday during our initial meeting. So I really praise all of you for the support to this endeavor. Now, let me draw the conclusion. Lastly, I would like to introduce and welcome Rear Admiral Thomas Guy, Combined Joint Operation from the Sea, CJO's Deputy Director, who will replace me as a chairman of the COE Directors Conference at the end of the current year. Admiral, I wish him, you, good luck in this endeavor, and I offer my availability to support your efforts, providing you with the experience I have developed over the course of the last two, not one, thanks to your confidence, your trust to me, exceptional years. Enough from me for now. I wish you all a fruitful conference and a pleasant stay, first and foremost, in Vicenza. Thank you so much. Now, if I may introduce you the mayor of the city, please, sir, Mr. Francesco Rucco, who will be translated by Warrant Officer, Chief Warrant Officer Antonio Spelli.
Un cordiale buongiorno a tutti i presenti, a tutte le autorità civili e militari, agli alti ufficiali della NATO e a tutti i direttori dei 28 centri di eccellenza della NATO sparsi nel mondo.
A warm welcome to all present attendees, NATO high-ranking officers and all the directors of the 28 NATO centers of excellence located around the world.
La città di Vicenza è fiera ed orgogliosa di poter ospitare questo importantissimo evento che mette a confronto i vari centri con l'obiettivo di garantire una cooperazione sempre più forte a favore della NATO.
The city of Vicenza is proud and honored to be able to host this very important event that enables the various centers to compare their experience with the objective of guaranteeing an increasingly strong cooperation in favor of NATO.
In questi giorni posso davvero sentirmi il sindaco della capitale mondiale della NATO, visto che qui si stanno confrontando le migliori realtà.
In these days I can really feel like the mayor of NATO's world capital, since here the best assets are cooperating with each other.
Questo summit è indubbiamente un valore aggiunto per Vicenza, che sta diventando un polo aggregativo a livello nazionale su più fronti.
This summit is surely an added value for Vicenza that is becoming an aggregation hub at national level on more fronts.
È sicuramente un valore aggiunto per la promozione della nostra città, un modo per farla conoscere a tante persone provenienti da tutto il mondo che hanno la possibilità di viverla e visitarla.
It's a positive factor for promoting the city, a way to make Vicenza known to many people coming from all over the world that have the possibility of living and visiting it.
Ricordo che nel weekend appena trascorso abbiamo ospitato in Basilica Palladiana il nostro monumento UNESCO, Patrimonio dell'Umanità, che avete avuto occasione di visitare anche ieri sera, un evento con centinaia di giovani provenienti da tutta Italia, organizzato dalla Confederazione Nazionale dell'Artigianato, CNA.
I would like to remind to everyone the fact that last weekend we hosted an event organized by the National Association of Artisans with hundreds of young people from all over Italy in the Basilica Palladiana, our UNESCO World Heritage Monument that you had the opportunity to visit yesterday.
Un'altra attività sempre più grande, grazie al fascino e alla bellezza dei nostri monumenti storici, che ci ha portati a presentare la candidatura per diventare città capitale italiana della cultura per l'anno 2024.
An increased attractiveness, thanks to the charm and beauty of our historical monuments, that led us to present our application for Italian Capital of Culture in 2024.
Vicenza è lieta di ospitare da anni nella caserma Chinotto il centro della NATO, il COESPU, entità il cui operato diventa sempre più importante nella configurazione geopolitica attuale, che richiede figure professionalmente preparate in modo adeguato.
Vicenza is happy to have hosted for many years now within the General Chinotto Barracks the NATO SPCOE and the COESPU, entities which work becomes increasingly important in the current geopolitical configuration that requires adequately prepared professional figures.
I centri di eccellenza che operano a favore della NATO sono impegnati in vari settori e qui in città in particolare il centro è specializzato nella polizia di stabilità, ovvero nelle attività che vedono impegnate le forze di polizia nel garantire lo Stato di diritto e la protezione dei diritti umani nelle operazioni di pace e nel contribuire al mantenimento dell'ordine e della sicurezza pubblica.
NATO centers of excellence are employed in different sectors and here in the city in particular. The center is specialized in stability policing, which is a set of activities that employ police forces to guarantee the rule of law and the protection of human rights in peace operations, contributing to public order and security.
Voglio ringraziare l'Arma dei Carabinieri, espressione dell'eccellenza all'interno del mondo militare e in possesso di una vasta e diversificata esperienza nelle missioni internazionali, per essere diventata leadership del progetto per lo sviluppo di tale settore dell'alleanza.
I would like to thank the Carabinieri Corps, expression of excellence within the military world, which possesses a vast and diversified experience in international missions to undertake leadership in the project of developing stability policing within the Alliance.
Infine auguro a tutti un fruttuoso e positivo lavoro, una felice permanenza qui a Vicenza, città che vi onora e che vi onora e ringrazia per quanto state facendo per la sicurezza e la stabilità nel mondo. Grazie.
I wish everyone a fruitful and positive work and a happy stay in Vicenza, a city that honors you and thanks you for what you're doing for the world's security and stability. Thank you.
His Excellency is the prefect of Vicenza, the entire province, is the highest authority, the province. He's going to address the audience. Thank you, sir.
Good morning to everyone. It's very nice to meet you here in Vicenza. Porgo il mio saluto innanzitutto al direttore del Centro di Eccellenza NATO per la Polizia di Stabilità di Vicenza, il colonnello dei Carabinieri Giuseppe De Magistris, e lo ringrazio per aver voluto ospitare un breve intervento del prefetto in occasione dell'apertura di questi importanti lavori della conferenza dei direttori dei centri di eccellenza NATO.
I greet the director of the NATO Stability Policing Center of Excellence, Carabinieri Colonel Giuseppe De Magistris, and I thank him for having given me the time to deliver a brief speech during the opening of the conference of the directors of NATO Centers of Excellence.
Saluto tutti loro, come anche tutte le altre autorità presenti, tra cui vorrei specificamente citare, visto il contesto, innanzitutto il direttore del COESPU, il generale di brigata Giovanni Pietro Barbano, e il direttore della Gendarmeria Europea, il colonnello Paolo Gonçalves della Guardia Nazionale Repubblicana Portoghese.
I greet all of them, as well as the other authorities which are present, amongst which I would like to specifically mention, given the context, the director of the COESPU of Vicenza, Brigadier General Giovanni Pietro Barbano, and the director of the European Gendarmerie Force, Colonel Paolo Gonçalves, Portuguese Guardia Nazionale Repubblicana.
Vorrei poi riservare un particolare saluto al sottosegretario di Stato alla Difesa, la senatrice Stefania Pucciarelli, con la quale abbiamo proprio di recente avuto modo di condividere le avversità atmosferiche del Monte Grappa in occasione di una recente suggestiva cerimonia che ha certamente temprato la nostra capacità di resistenza. Grazie per la sua presenza qui.
I would also like to greet Under Secretary of Defense Stefania Pucciarelli in particular, with whom we recently shared the atmospheric asperities of Monte Grappa during an impressive ceremony that has surely tempered our resistance capacity. Thank you for your presence here.
Un ultimo saluto vorrei rivolgerlo al generale di corpo d'armata dell'Arma dei Carabinieri Antonio Paparella, da poco giunto al prestigioso comando interregionale Vittorio Veneto di stanza a Padova, con cui non abbiamo ancora avuto modo di conoscerci personalmente e a cui auguro un felicissimo e fruttuoso periodo di permanenza in Veneto.
My last greeting to Carabinieri Lieutenant General Antonio Paparella, recently arrived at the prestigious Interregional Command Vittorio Veneto based in Padua, whom I haven't met yet, but to whom I wish a happy permanence period in the Veneto region.
È per me davvero un onore essere con voi qui oggi in questo splendido palazzo che risale al XVI secolo e che presenta evidenze di quella ispirazione palladiana che tanto connota la meravigliosa città di Vicenza. È anche l'occasione per svolgere delle brevissime riflessioni prima dei vostri lavori sul tema dello stability policing, attività di prioritario rilievo strategico non sempre ben percepita e conosciuta dal grande pubblico.
It's an honor to be here with you in this beautiful palace that dates back to the 16th century and that presents evidence of that Palladian inspiration that is a typical connotation of beautiful Vicenza. This is also an opportunity to briefly reflect on the theme of stability policing, strategic activity not always well perceived and known by the greater public.
In effetti, la visibilità esterna degli importanti obiettivi riconducibili alle attività di istituto assolte dal NATO ESPICOE, come dagli altri centri di eccellenza che si occupano di polizia di stabilità, almeno per quanto ho potuto riscontrare nella mia esperienza vicentina, non sempre è adeguata rispetto al qualificante riscontro in ambito internazionale e nei più disparati teatri operativi della nevralgicità da attribuirsi all'opera di questi centri di formazione, capaci di precostituire basi teoriche e cognitive, oltre che di addestramento, per interventi di non facile disimpegno in situazioni di crisi ad opera di forze di polizia ad ordinamento civile o militare.
In effect, the external visibility of the important objectives carried out by the NATO SPCOE and by the other centers that are involved with stability policing, at least according to my experience here in Vicenza, is not always adequate compared to the significant international feedback and to that obtained in the most disparate theaters of operation. The importance of these training centers, capable of creating the theoretical and cognitive basis, in addition to the formative basis, to intervene in complex crisis situations by military or civilian police forces.
Ricordo a me stesso, da questo punto di vista, l'enorme significato da addurre sia a livello di Alleanza Atlantica, ma anche a livello europeo e nazionale, alla possibilità di disporre di centri di produzione dottrinaria e al tempo stesso di formazione per poter assicurare nelle operazioni di pace internazionali una capacità di risposta e sviluppo delle stesse forze locali, al fine di consentire direttamente alle autorità dei paesi di intervento, le host nation, eventualmente una volta ricostituite, di essere in grado di mantenere l'ordine e la sicurezza pubblica senza aiuti esterni. Questo ovviamente esprime l'esigenza di un approccio teorico e formativo di carattere multilivello, olistico, come ha detto il colonnello De Magistris, dovendosi prevedere l'impiego di una combinazione di strumenti politici, civili e militari per la gestione delle situazioni di crisi oggetto di intervento.
I remind myself, from this point of view, of the enormous significance to invoke at Atlantic Alliance level, but also at European and national level, the possibility to dispose of centers of doctrinal production and at the same time training to ensure in the course of international peacekeeping operation a capacity of response and development of local forces in order to enable directly the host nation, once reconstituted, to maintain public order and security without external support. This obviously expresses the need for a multi-level theoretical and formative approach, holistic, as Colonel De Magistris said, having to foresee the employment of a combination of political, civil and military instruments for the management of crisis situations which are subject to interventions.
È una funzione che dobbiamo ritenere ancora ed assolutamente fondamentale negli attuali assetti geopolitici. Probabilmente ancora di più dopo la recente e drammatica conclusione della missione internazionale in Afghanistan, che apre scenari di evoluzione delle tensioni nell'area che credo dovranno essere oggetto di attenta considerazione.
It is a function that we have to consider still and absolutely fundamental in the current international geopolitical assets, probably even more after the recent and dramatic conclusion of the international mission in Afghanistan, that opens tense evolving scenarios in the area, and that I think will have to be subject of consideration.
Qui a Vicenza ritengo che l'attenzione al tema della Polizia di Stabilità abbia assunto un rilievo del tutto peculiare, quasi come se si fosse formato una specie di dipartimento, o forse meglio qualificarlo come un hub della Stability Policing, di diverso respiro internazionale e con grande capacità di integrazione, che vede operare nello stesso pregevole contesto logistico, la caserma Chinotto, sia il NATO ESPICOE, che il COESPU e la Gendarmeria Europea, che potrei definire come un punto di arrivo delle basi formative e dottrinarie, che si traduce nella realizzazione di un vero e proprio contingente internazionale di forze di polizia ad ordinamento militare da destinare in concreto alle attività di stability policing nei teatri interessati.
Here in Vicenza, I think that the particular attention on the theme of stability policing has reached an important and peculiar level, as if a kind of department has been formed, or better, a hub of stability policing with different international aspects and with a great capacity of integration that sees the cooperation in the same valuable logistic context of the Chinotto Barracks, the NATO SPCOE, the COESPU and the European Gendarmerie Force, that I could define as an arrival point of the formative and doctrinal basis that translates in the creation of a real international contingent of police forces with a military status to be concretely employed in stability policing activities.
Dunque, grazie a tutti. Grazie a tutti per lo strategico ruolo che assolvete nello scacchiere internazionale. E come ha già fatto il sindaco Rucco, vorrei cogliere anche io questo spunto per riservare un grazie particolare anche all'Arma dei Carabinieri, che nel contesto specifico assolve ad un ruolo di particolare pregnanza, avendo potuto nel tempo mettere a fattor comune la propria risalente esperienza di missioni internazionali di pace in scenari di crisi o post-crisi, al fine di assicurare un contributo davvero importante alla teorizzazione delle elaborazioni dottrinarie di stability policing.
Thanks therefore to everyone for the strategic role that you carry out in the international exchequer, and I would also like to take the opportunity, as Mayor Rucco said before, to reserve a special thanks also to the Carabinieri that in the specific context carry out a particularly important role, having had the possibility in the course of time to share the experience developed during international peace missions in crisis and post-crisis scenarios, in order to ensure an important contribution to theorize the doctrinal elaborations of stability policing.
Nel fare pervenire dunque a tutti i convenuti dei NATO COE i sensi della mia più alta considerazione, auguro un felice soggiorno a Vicenza ed un ottimo svolgimento dei lavori programmati che confido possano costituire occasione ulteriore di crescita in un settore di primario rilievo per gli interessi della pace mondiale. Grazie.
In conveying therefore my highest consideration to all the present NATO centers of excellence, I wish you a pleasant stay in Vicenza and an excellent development of the planned conference that I trust can offer an opportunity for further growth in a primary important sector for the interest of world peace. Thank you.
Eccellenza, grazie. Now is the time for Secretary of State, the Minister of Defense, Senator Stefania Pucciarelli. The floor is yours, madam.
Grazie, buongiorno a tutti. Rivolgo a tutti i presenti il più caloroso benvenuto in Italia a nome del Ministro della Difesa italiano, onorevole Lorenzo Guerini, mio personale e di tutto il comparto militare italiano. Siamo grati della vostra adesione e vi auguriamo un produttivo e piacevole soggiorno nel nostro Paese.
Good morning everybody. I would like to extend to all of you my personal wholehearted welcome to Italy on behalf of Defense Minister Lorenzo Guerini and the whole Defense Ministry. Thank you for joining the conference and let me wish you a productive and pleasant stay in our country.
Saluto i rappresentanti delle articolazioni di vertice dell'Alleanza, SHAPE, SACTI, NATO, HQ e tutti i direttori dei centri di eccellenza NATO. contributori fondamentali rispetto all'epocale processo avviato nel 2003 per guidare la necessaria evoluzione dello strumento militare in termini di organizzazione, forze, capacità e dottrina.
Let me greet the representatives of SHAPE, SAC-T, NATO HQ, leading authorities and all the directors of NATO Centers of Excellence, which are the fundamental contributors to the historical process launched in 2003 to guide this most needed evolution of the armed forces in terms of organization, forces, capabilities and doctrine.
Come recentemente sottolineato dal nostro Presidente della Repubblica, per i 70 anni di presenza della NATO in Italia, l'Alleanza Atlantica rappresenta per l'Italia una pietra angolare della politica di sicurezza, con risultati che sono evidenti e straordinari, primo fra tutti i 70 anni di pace nel continente europeo.
As the President of the Republic underscored on the occasion of the 70th anniversary of NATO's presence in Italy, for Italy, the Atlantic Alliance is the cornerstone of the security policy, and its results are clear and extraordinary. At the first place, the 70 years of peace we experienced in Europe.
La volontà di ospitare il più importante appuntamento annuale dei COE in questo Istituto Militare di Vicenza, di cui ringrazio il direttore e tutta la macchina organizzativa, è ulteriormente testimonianza della vicinanza rivolta alla NATO della nostra nazione ed un tangibile segnale dell'interesse verso le sue dinamiche e gli sforzi per mantenere il vantaggio competitivo in cui i COE sono parte attiva.
The willingness to host COE's most important annual event at our Vicenza Military Institute, for which I would like to thank the director and all the organization, further testifies Italy and NATO's close relationship and is a tangible sign of the interest for its dynamics and for the efforts aimed at maintaining our competitive advantage in which COE's are an active part.
I centri di eccellenza esprimono infatti una qualificante professionalità ampiamente riconosciuta che in questi anni ha confermato sul campo la bontà del lavoro svolto nel supportare l'Alleanza Atlantica, i suoi Paesi membri e i partners nei cosiddetti quattro pilastri della trasformazione: formazione e addestramento, ammaestramenti, sviluppo dottrinale e standardizzazione, sviluppo concettuale e sperimentazione.
The Centers of Excellence, in fact, express a qualified, broadly recognized professionalism, which over the last few years has confirmed the excellent job they have done in supporting the North Atlantic Alliance, member countries and partner countries in implementing the so-called four pillars of transformation: training and education, lessons learned, concept development and doctrine, standardization and interoperability.
Meglio di ogni parola sono i dati a dimostrare quanto la difesa italiana creda in questa realtà. Siamo supporting nation in ben 18 centri dei 27 complessivamente accreditati ed in tre di essi rivestiamo il ruolo di framework nation.
Hard facts, better than any words, prove the Italian Defense Ministry's strong belief in these realities. We are a supporting nation in 18 out of 27 certified centers of excellence, including three where Italy is a framework nation.
Mi riferisco al Modeling and Simulation di Roma, a Security Force Assistance di Cesano in provincia di Roma e a questo Stability Policing di Vicenza, dedicati a settori che rappresentano vere eccellenze nazionali che l'Italia ha messo a disposizione dell'Alleanza.
I'm referring to Rome Modeling and Simulation COE, Cesano in Rome Province, Security Force Assistance COE, and Vicenza Stability Policing COE, dedicated to national sectors of excellence that Italy made available to the Alliance.
Vorrei cogliere questa occasione per ricordare come l'Italia consideri essenziale lavorare convintamente per una NATO che, pur nella sua dimensione regionale transatlantica, sia pronta in maniera coesa ad affrontare le sfide globali mantenendo un approccio realmente a 360 gradi.
Let me take this opportunity to recall that Italy believes in the fundamental importance of working with determination for a NATO which, even in its regional transatlantic dimension, is ready to tackle global challenges cohesively, maintaining a real 360 degrees approach.
Una NATO che tenga conto di ogni tipo di minaccia in ogni dominio e consideri tutte le direzioni strategiche, con particolare riferimento a quel fianco sud che coincide in larga parte con il Mediterraneo allargato, certamente area di interesse strategico italiano, ma anche spazio geopolitico di importanza storica per gli equilibri globali.
A NATO which takes into consideration all kinds of threats in every domain and in all strategic directions, in particular with regard to the southern flank, which coincides to a very large extent with the enlarged Mediterranean, our national area of strategic interest, but also a geopolitical space of historical importance for global equilibria.
Proprio lo scorso 14 giugno 2021, nel 31° summit della NATO, i capi di Stato e di Governo dei 30 Paesi alleati si sono riuniti a Bruxelles per riaffermare l'unità, la solidarietà e la coesione e per aprire un nuovo capitolo nelle relazioni transatlantiche, in un momento in cui il contesto di sicurezza che abbiamo di fronte è sempre più complesso, dinamico e interrelato.
On 14 June 2021, the heads of state and government of NATO's 30 member countries met in Brussels to reaffirm the unity, solidarity and cohesion of the Alliance and to open a new chapter in the transatlantic relationship at a time when the security context we have to face is increasingly complex, dynamic and interrelated.
Uno dei temi al centro del Summit 2021 è stata l'Agenda 2030 dell'Alleanza Atlantica, pensata anche tramite l'apporto di personalità ed esperti esterni per offrire una solida base concettuale sulla quale costruire il programma per il futuro della sicurezza collettiva e per rispondere efficacemente alle sfide di oggi e del domani.
One of the central themes of the NATO 2021 Summit was the Atlantic Alliance 2030 Agenda. An agenda developed also through the contributions of experts and personalities external to NATO to give the Alliance a sound conceptual foundation to build its program for our future collective security and to respond effectively to current and future challenges.
L'Agenda 2030 rappresenta infatti la bussola politico-concettuale per la redazione del nuovo concetto strategico, documento che delineerà chiaramente le priorità, le criticità e gli obiettivi per i prossimi anni, che dovrebbe essere presentato al prossimo vertice di Madrid nel 2022.
The NATO 2030 Agenda is in fact the political and conceptual compass for the development of the new strategic concept, the document that will clearly define our priorities, critical issues and objectives for the next years, and that is probably going to be presented during the Madrid 2022 summit.
La revisione di questo documento cardine di indirizzo strategico, l'ultima versione risale al 2010, sarà un passaggio fondamentale nel processo di rinnovamento della NATO, anche una cartina di tornasole su quanto finora fatto, e rappresenterà senza dubbio uno degli impegni più complessi per il futuro dell'Alleanza Atlantica.
Reviewing this fundamental strategic guidance, whose last version dates back to 2010, will be a critical step for NATO's adaptation process and a litmus test for what was done so far. It will also for sure be one of the most complex but also most important challenges for the future of the Atlantic Alliance.
Quell'alleanza che rimane il fondamento della nostra difesa collettiva e che continuerà a lottare per la salvaguardia e promozione di pace, sicurezza e stabilità, preparandosi ad affrontare le difficili sfide poste dalle risorse nuove assertività geopolitiche, dalla minaccia del terrorismo, dagli attacchi informatici, dall'impatto sulla sicurezza dei cambiamenti climatici.
The Alliance is the foundation of our collective defense and will continue to fight to safeguard and promote peace, security and stability while preparing to tackle the difficult challenges posed by new and resurgent geopolitical assertiveness, from the threat of terrorism to cyber attacks and the impact of climate change on security.
Sono certa che la professionalità, l'impegno e il gioco di squadra con cui tutti voi animerete questo convegno contribuiranno ad identificare i punti di forza, debolezze e opportunità delle organizzazioni da voi rappresentate, con l'obiettivo di produrre un documento di lavoro utile a individuare e guidare i cambiamenti necessari per rimanere rilevanti e competitivi nel complesso panorama internazionale.
I'm sure that the professionalism, commitment and team spirit with which all of you will take part in this important conference will contribute to identify the strengths and weaknesses of and opportunities for your organizations to develop a document useful to identify and guide the necessary changes to keep being relevant in this complex international scenario.
Grazie per l'attenzione e buon lavoro.
Thank you for your attention. I wish you a successful conference.
Senatore, grazie. Thank you so much. And before giving the floor to Colonel Francesco Pacillo, CPD branch head, I would like to have the honor, if you don't mind, to present you with the coat of arms of the Center of Excellence, which highlights the 9 countries which are part of this. Just a token of appreciation, in modo per ringraziarla. Grazie a lei. Francesco, the floor is yours. Now is the NATO part.
Thank you, Giuseppe. Distinguished authorities, dear COE directors, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. As mentioned before, I'm Colonel Francesco Pacillo of the Italian Army, serving at the headquarters of the Supreme Allied Commander Transformation in Norfolk, Virginia, United States. COE Program Development Branch Head in the Joint Force Development Directorate. Today and together with Colonel De Magistris, I'm honored to co-chair this annual conference, this annual COE Director Conference. Welcome you all, and let me express my great pleasure to meet again in person the COE directors in this wonderful venue in Vicenza. Please let me pass the floor to my boss, Deputy Chief of Staff for Joint Force Development, and inviting him to address the audience.
Thank you, Francesco. Distinguished authorities, COE directors, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Buongiorno a tutti. I'm Major General Guillermo Cabo of the Spanish Air Force, Deputy Chief of Staff for Joint Force Development, Allied Commander Transformation. I'm very glad to be able to participate for the first time to this event in person, in the presence of the Center of Excellence community, as well as a representative for NATO and John Civilian Disruptor from the Atlantic Forum. As already mentioned, General Ruggiero, Deputy Supreme Allied Commander Transformation, is unable to attend this conference as he would have a wish. On his behalf, I want to express his apology to the audience for his absence, his appreciation to the organizer for the hard work, and a warm welcome to you all to the 2021 NATO Center of Excellence Directors Conference. I would like to thank the Italian authorities for the support of this event, namely the Undersecretary of Defense, Ms. Stefania Pucciarelli, the Prefect of Vicenza Province, Mr. Pietro Signorello, the Mayor of the Vicenza Municipality, Mr. Francesco Rucco, and the Carabinieri Northeast Interregional Commander, Lieutenant General Antonio Paparella. Let me thank as well to the Deputy Assistant Secretary General for Defense Investment, the focal point of contact of the NATO headquarters on all topics related with the Center of Excellence, and his support is crucial to improve the Center of Excellence visibility at the political level in NATO. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the organizer from the Allied Command Transformation and the director of the NATO Stability Policy and Center of Excellence for hosting this event offered by Confindustria. At the beginning of this year, NATO released its warfighting capstone concept, which is designed to be the Alliance military North Star toward 2040. Proactively focusing on the notion of a military instrument of power that is agile in thinking and acting and able to answer to any kind of challenge in whatever situation. The theme of this year conference, evolving to stay fit for purpose, in my opinion, is particularly important and timely. This is how the NATO Center of Excellence would like to contribute to the implementation of the NATO warfighting capsule concept and the development of the warfare development agenda. The warfighting capstone concept will provide an organizational framework that will guide and align our alliance and allied warfare development efforts, enabling NATO and nation to build a decisive military advantage. As a former Supreme Allied Commander Transformation General Lanata stated, NWCC ambition is about thinking, organizing and acting differently. This is the critical condition for our success in the future. Allow me now focus on the Center of Excellence. As you know, your primary purpose is supporting the Alliance transformation endeavor while avoiding the duplication of assets, resources and capability already present within the NATO command structure. To accomplish this task, you share your specific in-depth knowledge through training, conference, seminars, concept, doctrine, lesson learned, and papers. But in addition, you should be ready to help the Alliance to expand the interoperability, to increase capabilities, develop doctrine and standard, conduct analysis, evaluate lesson learned, and experiment in order to test and verify concepts. Moving now to COVID-19, as we reported to the Military Committee last December, despite the effects of the pandemic, the Center of Excellence have continued to be both adaptable and resilient in their response to the Alliance request. The effect of COVID on the overall program of work has been mitigated through innovative means such as the increase of line tools. Moreover, the pandemic did not prevent us from leaning toward further promoting the Center of Excellence capacity as a capacity multiplier for the Alliance. Indeed, thanks to your unique expertise, outreach capability and distinctive position outside NATO command structure, you are often able to leverage into sources of expertise not usually accessible to NATO, resulting in knowledge and expertise being available to NATO through the Center of Excellence. I therefore thank you for your continuous endeavor in this aspect. Let me now highlight Allied Command Transformation ongoing communication effort on the added value of the Center of Excellence for the Alliance. Initiatives to demonstrate the relevance of the Center of Excellence include the new annual report, which not only highlights the significant achievement of each individual Center of Excellence in the past year, but also emphasize the activities of the current program of work. The first report released last March was well received at NATO HQ, and with some improvement will be the basis for our next annual update to the Military Committee early next year. On the technical side, ACT has also improved the process for requesting support from the Center of Excellence. A revised online tool on Transnet aims to simplify this process. The data collected through the new annual report and the revised request for support tool have enabled ACT to identify more easily and precisely the support provided to NATO from the Center of Excellence. From a simple quantitative analysis, we have seen that 35% increase in the number of requests in direct support of NATO in 2021 when compared with 2020, with over 60% of the Center of Excellence line of efforts directly supporting the Alliance. In addition, following North Atlantic Council approval of the new policy for Center of Excellence early last year, we are now awaiting a formal tasking from the Military Committee to begin the review of the Center of Excellence accreditation and periodic assessment procedures, which will include an update of the criteria required to receive and maintain NATO accreditation. This update will be followed by a review of the questionnaires used during the assessment that will provide more detailed quantitative and qualitative information, allowing a better assessment of the benefits of the Center of Excellence products and services for NATO. Turning to the 2022 program of work and the way forward, in the summit held last June, NATO promoted the transformation agenda. Allied head of state pledged to expand innovation, resilience, and adaptability to gain a technological advantage over potential adversaries in the face of the members country of NATO. They pledged for implementation of the NATO warfighting capital concept through the warfare development agenda. This gives again me the opportunity to emphasize the importance of linking what we do to the priorities identified in the warfare development agenda and the related line of delivery so there is coherence and synergy to the Alliance adaptation efforts. Your program of work for 2022 are being discussed at this time of the year. Therefore, it's paramount to keep in mind that maybe for the first time in a long time, you now have a reference point to focus your effort toward a common objective, the adaptation of NATO military instrument power. We have already discussed the importance of giving the proper visibility to the vast and relevant range of activities that you perform in support of NATO. Providing evidence of the Center of Excellence response to NATO requests for support is important, but it's not enough. We must seize the attention of NATO HQ, ACO, and ACT as well. I encourage you all to be proactive and creative when coming up with ideas and proposals in this field. In this sense, the Center of Excellence Marketplace, having received a lot of appreciation in the past and being still a valid initiative, could be further developed. For example, instead of just having one big event, why not organize several through the year, gathering a smaller number of Center of Excellence grouped by domain or a specific area of interest. In this way, the Center of Excellence and the participants involved will have more time to deepen mutual understanding and building lasting cooperation, something to be considered during this conference. Finally, in ACT, we are well aware that one of the greatest challenges for the Center of Excellence is the filling of the subject matter expert position by sponsoring nation. Although it is difficult to relate fill rate with the outputs, there is concern when numbers decrease. ACT will continue highlighting this situation to the nation at the military committee level through the periodic assessment report, and I expect you will do the same through your steering committee. I'm aware that some COEs are using innovative solutions to fill the gaps with temporary solutions, and it would be grateful. It would be great if you could share your experience with your fellow director during the conference. In conclusion, over the next 3 days, you will have the opportunity to share thoughts and exchange ideas between COE director, but also with John Disruptor coming from the civilian world, who may have some interesting and novel ideas they wish to bring to the table. Renard Ruggiero and I look forward to receiving the report that will follow this event with your analysis and proposal for the future. I'm sure that you will make the most of this great opportunity, and I hope you enjoy the conference. Thank you very much for your attention.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you, sir, for your words, emphasizing again how the COEs, NATO-accredited COEs, are important for the Alliance and for all of us. Before passing again the floor to Colonel De Magistris, I would like to wish you all a fruitful discussion in the next days. Thank you again.
Apologies, Francesco. I didn't realize that you were taking the floor. My apologies. Just to pass the floor to the next briefer is from the Defense Investment Division at NATO Quarter International Staff, is Mr. Holger Ziegler. The floor is yours, sir.
Mr. Chairman, Excellencies, Directors, Generals, ladies and gentlemen. First, let me convey the wishes from Deputy Assistant Secretary General, Mr. Robert Weaver, for a successful conference you are having down here. It's a privilege for me to convey some welcoming remarks from the NATO Headquarter International Staff for your Directors' Conference. Let me thank the Italian authorities, especially Senatrice Pucciarelli, the Prefecto Signorello, and Colonel De Magistris for the organization of such a nice conference in such an impressive venue and a very nice city, I must say. And thanks also to my colleagues at ACT, General Cavo and Colonel Pacello, for the organization. The theme of the conference, evolving to stay fit for purpose, harmonizes with the wider debate in the alliance and the ongoing adaptation process. NATO 2030 complements and builds on our ongoing political and military adaptation, strengthens our ability to deliver on the core tasks, and contributes to making the alliance ready for the future. NATO HQ and allies increasingly recognize the expertise and potential that rests with the Center of Excellences. The pandemic situation has again underlined the relevance of NATO Center of Excellence. Many of you have contributed to activities and crisis postures, both to NATO as well as directly with allies. We need to preserve the lessons identified and take them forward to optimize best practices and pursue any adaptation required. Looking at the Brussels summit, one can notice a convergence between current challenges and the establishment of COEs. Let me just highlight a few examples. The IMD COE to help allies in fulfilling their commitment to improve NATO's integrated air and missile defense capabilities. The Maritime Security COE to support NATO's effort in reinforcing the maritime posture to protect sea lines of communications. The NATO Space Center of Excellence to assist efforts on NATO's adaptation and response to challenges in the space sector. Last but not least, also the offer by one ally for a COE on climate. NATO has the intent to incorporate climate change cooperation into the full spectrum of work, ranging from defense planning and capability development to civil preparedness and exercises. There will be many more opportunities for COEs to engage in this discussion, considering also that NATO is working on a new strategic concept. DSG Defense Investment has a role of the senior international staff official to act as an advocate in the international staff for the COEs. To optimize the use of COEs at NATO headquarters and to bring visibility across the alliance and to foster their recognition. He pursues this in close coordination with our colleagues at ACT. Many of you have already well-established links with NATO communities and within the international staff divisions. Some of you are leading significant strands of work or are chairing groups. Let me just reassure you, there's no intent from our side to disrupt what is already working well. But we all know that new challenges will require interaction with different stakeholders. We stand ready to support you in identifying and navigating through the international staff and the committee structure and to establish necessary links that you can find your right counterparts. We are also standby to provide you with assistance on NATO policies, NATO perspectives, material standardizations, or with regards to industry relations, just to name a few examples. In the same vein, we are assisting other IS divisions to reach out to you that they can find the right center of excellence in support of their work, if so wished. Emerging and disruptive technologies will require interaction also with industry. NATO is engaged in the non-procurement and the procurement relations with industry already. In this way, the framework for NATO industry engagement aims at improving interaction between NATO and the industry while fostering a more coherent relationship, providing relevant inputs for harmonization of national and multinational capability requirements. This includes, for example, the NATO Industry Advisory Group as key group for studies and advice, which has also been utilized from some of your centers, as well as, for instance, the NATO Industry Forum, which is a strategic interaction led by ACT and Defense Investment and will be held in Rome in November this year. But, and that may be also something to highlight again, includes also support for COE Industry Days, which some of you are pursuing with the aim to understand the latest technological developments, allowing you to define particular requirements in support of your work. We from Defense Investment will be reaching out to you later this year to seek your active participation in a workshop that is planned mid of December on distributed synthetic training as a roadmap towards future capabilities. Let me just close to wish you a fruitful conference, inspiration by this beautiful place, allowing you to think out of the box to achieve your goal to innovate and survive to stay fit for purpose. Thank you for your attention, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Now we will have the break and the group photo, then the senator is to leave. So before going downstairs, I would like to thank once again Mrs. Laura Dallavecchia, President of Confindustria, and because without you, without your support, ma, all of this would have not been possible. So I would like to present you a small token of appreciation from the center. It's a crystal cube, but just a photo opportunity. Yes, please. Without further ado, Senator, let's join downstairs in the on the grass. The attention could be a little bit slippery. We'll have our photo opportunity, and then since we are not running late, but we have plenty of time, we will resume at 10:30 here for the more practical part. And I do thank once again all the Italian authorities, Senator Pucciarelli, for the your time, for the honor even to having you yesterday, Sua Eccellenza, His Excellency the Prefect, the Mayor, all the local authorities, and all my friends, my great friend from the European Gendarmerie Force, the Commander Paolo Gonçalves, Moncado Gonçalves, thank you so much, obrigado for having you here, and I would like to even to mention the NATO School of Ramelgau Commandant, beg your pardon, because he's one of the moderators of the SWOT analysis, but anyway, Mike, where are you? I cannot see you. Should be over there. Anyway, he's still around. And it shows that how the all by moving forward in unison, will we be able to make the difference? And so this speaks volumes about the commitment of the COE's director and NATO as a whole. So thank you so much. Thank you once again, General Spina, General Barbano, the Questore, the head of the State Police, the Guardia di Finanza commanding officer, Cosmo, welcome. And thank you once again to all of you. See you later, 10:30 sharp, please. On the grass and then the coffee afterward. Without headgear, so leave the hat here, please, or in a guardrobe on the left-hand side, the right-hand side. So without headgear. Thank you.
si spostano solo. Thank you.
So we didn't want to play tricks. We wanted to accommodate all of you a little bit better. So all the seats are in a strictly alphabetic order, so don't get offended, please. This is a lesson learned, Olga. Next time we have to display the seating plan on the video. It's a lesson learned. It's easier to arrest people rather than organizing a conference, trust me. No. Okay. So with your permission, sir, let's crack on with the second phase of this morning, which is dedicated to the keynote speech by ACT and the CEO. So I would like to invite on the podium Brigadier General Peter Was, or Was, apologies for my pronunciation, sir. It's Was? Was, apologies once again. From who is ACOS Strain at Shape. Sir, the floor is yours. Thank you. No, you have to, 1 second, sir. Where is it?
Okay.
Should be there somewhere. Oh, it's working. It's working.
So now it's working. Thank you for that. I did actually plan to show a few slides, but I will manage without it if it's not possible. So, thank you very much. Anyway, distinguished audience, allow me to express here from the start my gratitude towards the organizers for providing these fantastic and beautiful surroundings. Yesterday at the starting, and also today, it is. I have never had the pleasure to visit Vicenza before, but I have already mentioned to my wife that we need to come back for a few more days. Thank you also for providing me the opportunity to share some remarks on the relationship between Allied Command operations and the community of Centers of Excellence. I look forward to discussing with you the way ahead for the support for the COEs provide to ACO. Next slide, please. As the point of contact for all strategic level COE matters in ACO, I'm delighted that many ACO entities have for many years established effective bilateral relationships with COEs in their area of responsibility. With new COEs entering the community, more relationship will emerge and add further to this successful interaction. The bilateral day-to-day engagement have generated important real products for ACO entities in support of their development, adaptation, and operational conduct. They are indeed instrumental to the successful execution of these entities' functions. Thanks to the commitment of the subject matter experts in the COEs, ACO entities are able to address often pressing operational issues and base their development and adaptation on a more robust foundation. The COE's individual thematic focus and their organizational flexibility are assets for ACO's effort to become a more agile organization. The effects of the COE's support for ACO is more than just the sum of the bilateral relationships between individual ACO entities and individual COE's. Therefore, a comprehensive understanding of the COE's support for ACO should be achieved. Anecdotal evidence helps to illustrate what individual COE's offer, but we should continue to aim to develop a broader narrative of what constitutes the future relationship between COE's and ACO. Next slide, please. I would like to propose that at the core of such a broader narrative resides the acknowledgement that the community of COEs as a whole is a collective multiplier for ACO's efforts to pursue its strategic objectives, conduct its strategic initiatives, and respond to associated strategic risks and issues. Following this narrative, future ACO requests for COE support should be linked to SECURE's ACO Strategic Management Plan, ASMP, the ASMP, which directs and guides ACO adaptation and development in accordance with North Atlantic Council guidance. The ASMP is at the core of the ACO efforts to continuously innovate and evolve. The plan for the period 2021 to 25 was signed by SECURE on 4th of December last year. The annual update of the ASMP will be initiated later this month. For me, as the Secretary of the ACO Management Board, which on behalf of SECURE is responsible for the executive management of the ACO Strategic Management System, I am responsible to Chief of Staff SHAPE for leading this work. Next slide, please. Indeed, I should point out here that the development support required for the employment and monitoring of the ACO Strategic Management System is one of my core responsibilities. While I'm sorry to say the topic of COEs is an associated function, one that is not yet resourced, and I will come back to that a little bit later. Next slide, please. Due to the classification of the ASMP, I cannot go into details of the ACO goals, objectives and initiatives set forth by the plan. However, it will not surprise you to know that in its current and forthcoming versions, the plan operationalizes the strategic themes determined by NATO heads of state and government and other top-level policy documents, such as the NATO military strategy, the political guidance, the concept for deterrence and defense of the Euro-Atlantic area, the NATO warfighting capstone concept, the NATO 2030 initiative, and the forthcoming new strategic concept. Let me name just a few of the strategic themes. The operationalization of the cyberspace and space domains, the enhancement of readiness and deployability, the improvement of strategic anticipation and deterrence management, the utilization of innovation and exploitation of emerging and disruptive technologies, the increase of survivability and resilience, and also the strengthening of partnerships. ACO looks to the COEs for support in all of these and many other areas within the scope of the ASMP. The strategic theme of innovation and EDT can be considered a good example in this regard. As recently noted by the Chief of Staff SHAPE at a technology conference in Brussels, NATO is in the midst of an intense technological race with its competitors. However, Chief of Staff SHAPE pointed out that NATO has a strong innovation capacity and can build upon a range of existing structures. And I believe the community of COEs certainly plays a role in this context. With the ASMP as a key reference for the development of future ACO requests for COE support and the firm belief that the command needs to consider the COE community in its entirety, ACO aims to develop its structures and procedures accordingly. Our strategic aim is to ensure that ACO requests for COE support are coordinated across the command, prioritized in accordance with Chief of Staff SHAPE direction and guidance, and endorsed by ACO Command Group. We also look to provide ACO Command Group with a consolidated overview and assessment of completed, ongoing, requested, and planned COE support activities for ACO entities. The collation of feedback from ACO entities benefiting from COE support will be an important element of this assessment. So in a nutshell, we seek to generate a coherent, prioritized, and balanced list of ACO requests for COE support in accordance with the command's strategic direction, The list must be visible to and endorsed by ACO Command Group and followed up during and after its execution. In addition, ACO looks to continue. In addition, ACO looks to continue to support ACT for the establishment and accreditation of new COEs and the periodic assessment of existing COEs. Such support is critical to ensure that the operational warfighter perspective is appropriately reflected when considering and confirming the thematic scope of COEs. So although our aims are clear, I need to moderate both internal and external expectations. As mentioned, ACO still has no dedicated staffing capacity for this kind of coordination, facilitation and monitoring activities. However, SHAPE has recently initiated work to address this shortfall, and we aim to put in place an intermediate limited staffing capacity next year. Until then, we will continue to address critical and urgent taskings in the area of COEs as and when required. Next slide, please. The coordination and consultation with ACT and the NATO HQ International Military Staff and the International Staff and the engagement with the COE community are critical to achieve success in the short, mid and long term. And I just realize I have missed a slide. Hang on. And actually, it's an important slide.
Sir, we are getting the remote, so we can go back.
Yes, please. We need to go back to slide 5. Yeah, it's this one. Okay. I was talking about the ASMP, our ACO Strategic Management Plan, and the whole point is that we are, as ACO, looking to the COEs for support in all of these areas, many other areas within the scope of the ASMP. When it comes to the ASMP, we might wish to consider the possibility of COEs supporting the identification and assessment of risks and issues. And I want to stress this because this is actually the main target today to mention this. So your distinct position within the NATO enterprise and your unique set of knowledge, competences, and skill could enhance such effort. And for that reason, I invite you to review the current version of the ASMP and monitor the annual work to update the plan. I also invite you to review the ACO risk register and issue log, as well as the consolidated ACO strategic management reports. The plan, the ACO strategic management database, and respective reports are accessible through the SHAPE NATO information portal on the NATO secret network. Please do not hesitate to engage with my ACO management board secretariat, who will support you in this regard. And now two slides ahead, please. Thank you. So, distinguished audience members, my staff officer, Dr. Henrik Heidenkamp, and I look forward to the discussions today and over the next couple of days. We are ready to exchange views and to listen to your remarks and any questions you might have. Unfortunately, I will not be able to attend the full conference, but Dr. Heidenkamp will be here all week. Please also do not hesitate to contact us after the conference to continue the exchange of views and ideas how to enhance the future relationship between the COEs and ACO. With a little bit of confusion in my presentation here, I thank you very much for listening. Thank you.
So thank you, and if I may, for sure we will distribute your presentation after the conference, and if I may, I would like to present you a token of appreciation. It's the coat of arms of the Center of Excellence, which bears the 9 flags of the 9 sponsoring nations. Now it's the time of the ACT Special Advisor, the Special Advisor to SACTI on Innovation and NATO-EU Relationship, Brigadier General Dieter Kohl. Danke schön, sir. The floor is yours.
General Cavo, Giuseppe, Francesco, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege and an honor to have no mask in contrast to you guys. It's also most impressive, as we already saw, all of us over here, how the Italian side is hosting this very COE Directors Conference in such a splendid palace over here. And also thanks a lot once again for the wonderful icebreaker that we had yesterday evening. I think that was one of the examples how you can bridge differences and how you can bring together the community of interests of the directors of the centers of excellence. If I look around over here, I'm impressed by the paintings. But you may also realize that over here we also have a symbol of 2 international organizations. This means usually as military guys, we see that the flags have a special meaning for us. And if you look around over here, you will not only see the NATO flag, you will also see the European flag represented in this very room where we are currently present. And it is, if I could have the next slide, please. For me, a special honor and an occasion to address you on NATO-EU cooperation. And what's the aim? The aim is to provide some food for thought for your syndicate work over here. And I would be grateful if you could, throughout your syndicates, also discuss the factor and the opportunities and the challenges of NATO-EU cooperation. As underlined by Giuseppe, I'm also responsible for NATO-EU cooperation advice to General Lavigne, who unfortunately is today not present, and he is our new commander since the 23rd of September. And we see you as the directors of the Centers of Excellence as a forerunner of NATO-EU cooperation. And I will explain a little bit later why we see you as forerunners of NATO-EU cooperation. Vicenza is for me one of the best examples, and I think there are rare places in the world to underline what we need as complementary facets of NATO-EU cooperation.
You have the European Gendarmerie Force over here. If you look, for instance, at the developments of last week, you have another international organization, I do not know whether you know it, but the OSCE had an exercise related to migration, and where did it end last week? It ended over here in Vicenza. And the European Gendarmerie Force is to the hearts and minds of the Italian Gendarmerie Force, but also some other nations have Gendarmerie forces. I look out to one of your directors over here coming from Portugal. If I look to Spain, General Cabo. If I look to the Netherlands, I see that we have Gendarmerie forces all over Europe, and they represent a common capability within the hands of the European Union and of NATO. I want to provide you some thoughts related to the context of NATO-EU cooperation. I will also elaborate a bit on the achievements and on the way ahead, how we see it from headquarters SECTI perspective, and for sure an opportunity for you and us to have an exchange of views from practitioners' point of view, and I will elaborate why I see especially the practitioner's point of view as something that is really very important in contrast to political declarations. If I could have the next slide, please. You see over here the strategic context of NATO-EU cooperation. For sure we have the chapeau, the heading of the joint declarations that stem from two different summits of NATO, 2016 and 2017. And you find in there 74 proposals, but what I would like to underline, if you look at the different topics, that you, with your expertise, are best qualified in order to look, for instance, at one of the challenges of today's security environment. I start with countering hybrid threats, and that's also one of the examples where we need the European Union and NATO. And we have over here, by the way, and that is something that I really appreciate, the representative of the European Center of Excellence for Countering Hybrid Threats from Helsinki. That is also something that we need in that context as a crucial element and as an opportunity, if you ask me. If you look, for instance, how ministers met in Helsinki in order to discuss countering hybrid threats in tabletop exercises, then it is an element where, if you ask me, you cannot plan for collective defense in Europe with NATO without looking at the European Union capabilities. It is about nations and memberships. This means EU member states. And in that context, usually I also like to reference one of our former Supreme Allied Commander's Transformation, former or retired General James Mattis, former Secretary of Defense. He said, "Nothing is really new under the sun." And if I look, for instance, at Vicenza, and if you came over here this morning, I heard the bells calling the believers to go into the chapels, into the churches over here. And if you look back at the 16th century in Europe, you saw that we had fierce religious wars amongst the representatives of the believers of different religious approaches. And today I'm sometimes reminded, allow for this personal observation, that we have a schism of religion in Europe once again. This means 400 years later on. A schism between NATO and the European Union. We have so-called Atlanticists and we have Europeanists. And the question is, can we allow for an approach where we try to divide ourselves? And if you ask myself, having been responsible as Chief Executive Officer for the Director General of the European Union Military Staff, and having also worked on numerous occasions in the NATO organization, I think we have to merge. We cannot go for an approach where we have high priests in two different churches, the European Union and in NATO, without coming together. And the best way to come together is from a practitioner's point of view, from practical experiences that you have in your daily life, in order to underline what is possible in a complementary approach. Defense industry and research is done, on one hand, in America, where headquarters ACT is. It is also undertaken in Europe. We have supranational organizations in Europe that are also taking care of it. You have over here maritime experts that can allow for supporting operational cooperation, including maritime issues, and who can also look at migration. If you look, for instance, at Frontex, Frontex is within the European Union. Migration is a topic that is interrelated. And if you ask myself, we have to reach out to the sites where we have the relevant expertise. Defense capabilities. That is something where for sure we have to see also from headquarters sector perspective what is going on in NATO. We have the NDPP, the NATO defense planning process, but we also need to look out what is going on the European side. Exercises. This means Peter Wars already provided you some background from SHAPE perspective. Exercises provide opportunities. We have some on the European side, and we even have more on the NATO side, and we have national exercises. The bulk of all exercising is done within our own nations. Let's be realistic about it. And defense and security capacity building, this means partner engagement. You can do it through CSEs. We have the partnership training education centers. We have also approaches by the European Union and their partnership programs. So that's also something that is in reality interrelated. If I could have the next slide, please. We had a first intensive exchange of views with General Lavigne as the new commander of headquarters SECT, and he confirmed what General Lanata already provided to us. This means General Lavigne is in the same swim lane. We have to identify and nurture areas of cooperation between the two organizations. And that is also our strategic objective, still for this very year, but also for 2022, reconfirmed Friday, 10 days ago, by General Lavigne. Next slide, please. NATO and EU are providing us a basis for cooperation. Both organizations, and we need to be realistic about it, are similar but different. We, as headquarters SECT, and you, as the directors of centers of excellence, do not have natural counterparts on the European Union side. Let's be realistic about it. The European Union has a supranational aspect. This means that is something that is above our own intergovernmental approaches of NATO nations or of EU member states. We have some 32,000 experts and civil servants in the European Commission that are dealing with different aspects that are very interesting and enriching for us on the NATO side as well. I will come back to that later on. But we do not have, except for a very small military portion, military elements in the European Union. You have the EU Military Committee and you have the EU military staff. But that staff comprises some 200 officers, NCOs, and that's it. So it's only half the size of the international military staff of NATO. On the other hand, they can stand up on a case-by-case basis through force generation, operational headquarters, and force headquarters. And in addition to that, the European Union has recourse, for instance, to some agencies with excellent expertise. For instance, if you talk with General Lavigne, you will see that from the French perspective, he was responsible as former commander for air and space. And you were informed yesterday and also throughout the directors, at least when they had their meeting yesterday evening, related to space as a new topic and the incoming new center of excellence in France related to space. So the European Space Agency has already contributed to the BSC Space Working Group about 10 years ago. And when we had, for instance, Trevor Wargame with the UNESCO site and spacefaring nations in 2012, already at that period of time, we took recourse to the European Space Agency and their expertise. And education and training is quite important, if you ask me. That's one of the four pillars of you in the centers of excellence. And we have also with us over here the commandant of the NATO school in Nova Amagau. They also have some good basis in order to take that forward. Innovation was referenced on numerous occasions today. I reference in that context Giuseppe and your very eloquent introductory remarks related to innovation, my second head. And if we do not innovate related to space-based capabilities in the future, I think we will miss the train. Because even your bloody approach when you go to a gas station of Walmart in the United States of America will fail if you don't have the right timing and some GPS satellites are taken out of the equation. So we are very much dependent on capabilities in the future, and that is also represented in one of the upcoming COEs. We have JEPCC with us. JEPCC is currently our expertise related to space. One example where we have to interlink with different entities, it's not easy. If it were easy, we wouldn't come together over here. Next slide, please. One of the principles that we try to address is that we try to avoid unnecessary duplications between the European Union and NATO. We have to ensure the autonomy of decision-making in both organizations. But that, on the other hand, is positive for you as the COEs. Why? Because we can bring together subject matter expertise and then bring it up in our separate chains of command, be it on the NATO side, be it on the European side. And what we have to realize is that we have to step out of our comfort zone. What do I mean by that? Comfort zone is usually mill-to-mill talk. That is what we like because we feel amongst ourselves. But if you look at NATO-EU cooperation, my plea is always try to look for the complementary approach and the capacities of both organizations. And you will realize that you will have opportunities on the side of the European Union Commission, civilian expertise, that is complementary what we have in NATO in the military organization. And one of the topics that was already taken up on numerous occasions over here, and that will also be a core element of our warfare development agenda and our NATO warfighting capstone concept and deterrence and defense, is resilience. And if you look at resilience, you have to see that we have opportunities and necessities to take on board civilian aspects of critical infrastructure, for instance, because we are heavily depending on it from a military point of view. We have one example, cyber defense. Cyber defense is not about the military only. This means we have the cyber defense COE, the director is with us over here, and we have the opportunity to look out what is also going on the European side. We have, for instance, a permanent structured cooperative approach led by Lithuania related to cyber defense, a PESCO project. We have related to cyber different ministries of the interior that are dealing with cyber defense. Each nation has a different approach to cyber defense. And if we come to a cyber range, if you ask myself, does it really make a difference whether you put on that cyber range a NATO flag over there, a European flag, a national flag by one of our nations, or is it about the challenge itself? Because if you reach out to some of the CEOs of today's companies, for instance, they will tell you space and location is less and less relevant related to cyber defense. For sure, you can, at the end of the day, look where do you have the cloud being reflected in a practical location on the Earth. But on the other hand, it is not about a flag, it is not about an international organization. Cyber defense is something that is unfortunately broader, more encompassing, and therefore my plea, try to look also for expertise being reflected in the European Commission on that one. If I look at 5G, we have a very close cooperation between Headquarters SECTI and the European Commission, because 5G is something that is being taken forward outside of NATO. Let's be realistic. They are far ahead of us related to 5G. Latvia is currently having a flag related to 5G in their country. They are forward-leaning on that one. But I think all of us are very well off if we look outside of our own comfort zone and look at opportunities on the other side and invite expertise stemming from civilian EU entities and agencies for our events. And we had DI providing us some reflections on that, and COE Industry Days is also one of the examples where you can reach out in order to take in, to incorporate expertise from the other side. So 5G, space expertise, cyber resilience, all examples where we can bring together European Union entities, agencies, subject matter expertise from them and from NATO sites or NATO accredited COEs or the European Center of Excellence for Countering Hybrid Threats. If I could have the next slide, please. What areas did we support in the past through you, the forerunners of COEs as well? This means you have one advantage to official Brussels IS European External Action Service talks or talks between the two secretary generals of the two organizations or the two chairpersons of the EU Military Committee and the NATO Military Committee. You can come together and talk without the ebbs and flows of NATO-EU cooperation, without subtle political sensitivities. If you look, for instance, CBRN, we have the director over here with us as well. CBRN is a classical example where you can go for a symbiotic approach. We did it in the past, and what I would also like to convey as a message over here to you, look at the opportunities of the European Commission related to the budget. Horizon 2020 provides money if you have a good project that you want to take forward. And the CBRN COE did so in the past. CMRE will brief us later on as well. They also have money stemming from the European Commission in order to take activities and projects forward. It's possible, in principle, if you have the right project. Innovation and AI, let's be realistic, NATO is not ahead of that contest. And that is something where we need to look at opportunities outside of the NATO organizations. We do so, and we already reached out. This means General Lanata in his capacity as Supreme Allied Commander Transformation also addressed the EU Military Committee on that very topic in November 2019. In order to take it forward. I already mentioned multinational solutions and NDPP, the complementarity, cyber and strategic foresight analysis. Those who are interested to look a little bit outside of their own swim lane, I can recommend to you the two reports that were sent to the European Parliament by the European Commission on strategic foresight. The one in 2020 that was related to resilience as a backbone of the European continent, and the latest one that is also looking at the security challenges of Europe in the 21st century, especially in our decade. It's really enriching if you ask me. 2022 plus, what we discussed with General Lanata and something that you could take up in your syndicate works over here. Space, I already referenced it. It will be for sure one of the topics that we need to take into account. Space as a new operational domain is something that is to the heart and mind of shape of ourselves. This means we stood up a space center and we are standing up a COE. But I think it is broader than that, then, because most of you will have to take recourse to space-based capabilities. GMU METOC without space, I put a question mark. Climate and defense was referenced today by the Undersecretary of the Italian MOD. It is something that we also have on the radar. It is also part of the Brussels Summit 15th of June meeting of the heads of state and government. So we have it, whether we like it or not. Climate and defense is a topic. And resilience is in red over here. That is also my concluding element, because I say that is really worthwhile being in your hearts and minds as well, if you take forward the work in your COEs. And whether you do it through remote education and training, we had on the 16th of June an event together with different entities of the European Security and Defense College. We took on board the NATO Defense College. We had over there also the NATO School in Oberammergau and different entities. It's one of the four pillars that you have within your centers of excellence, most of you. And I think that remote education and training, especially in a blended way, is the approach of the future. You have seen it under COVID-19 conditions. You will also hopefully take the opportunities forward in 2022 and look for what is possible nowadays if you have the right digital backbone. With that, I have provided you my thoughts for your discussions over here. If there are any immediate questions, ready to take it. Otherwise, we can also do it in an offsite or throughout the syndicate work. That is a very challenging question, and it's a good one, because we have been, and I'm honest and forward-leaning candidate on that one, we had that discussion already for some period of time. Those who participated yesterday evening with the COE directors, it was also mentioned over there. In the Innovation Board, under the auspices of Deputy SecGen, we usually also discuss the issues of innovation, and one of the elements for sure is that we miss for the time being an enterprise approach, a NATO approach related to the digital platform. We still have for the time being not only the challenge that you are referencing with in one of the COEs and external customers, we even have it because we have different domains related to SHAPE, to headquarters SECT and NATO headquarters. It is a principle and a prerequisite to take it forward. You are absolutely spot on, if you ask me. If you don't have the opportunity to use the data in the very same domain, it's not helpful. If I, for instance, have my daughter works in New York, my kids are in Berlin, I myself in Norfolk. If I use Skype for Business or Skype, no issue, yeah, having information exchange by whatever means. Technically, it's possible. The question is, do we really establish it? Do we want to take it forward as an imposed NATO domain approach? On the unclassified version, I would say it's without any problems possible. Related to the classified version, we face an issue because NS1 is only applicable for some of the COEs that are usually co-located with the other NATO entities. For instance, if you look at the European Personal Recovery Center, you will realize that over there you have through the NATO entity that is in the very same compound, you have the opportunity. But what you are mentioning over here is currently not solved for most of the COEs. And it is something that we should also put, if you ask myself, General Carbo, that we should flag up once again when we provide the feedback throughout your SWOT analysis. It's one of the crucial elements that I would recommend to put in. it has to be taken forward, and we have to push, we have to continue pushing on that one, otherwise there will be no development in the right direction. And you are spot on with your question. Mike is coming.
Fully understand. One more question from my side, if may, sir. From my perspective as a director of COE, it's better if NATO institutions, NATO HQ and NATO command structure and other structures will implement one common platform, and after that we are much easier to adjust. That was my question, first of all, because if we have several platforms, even UNCLOS, it's really hard to find which one is the best, the common, and which one is the most suitable for customers. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning to all. My name is Stuart Finesse. I work for General Carvo. We've been having this discussion about common platforms. The feedback I've got so far is NCIA have a collaborative working platform group. It's likely they're going to recommend WebEx as the one for the unclassified side. They have been given $3 million to look at unclassified platforms, but as of yet, they haven't come up with anything on the way forward. Portals, we have a point of contact with inside NCIA for portals to share information, including COEs, and next week we're meant to have a meeting with them. I would also echo what General Cole said. We can't actually do portal work with SHAPE at the moment, let alone doing it externally. So this is not good news, but at least we're trying to explore it. Thank you.
Director. So, sir, regarding NATO-EU cooperation, on an UNCLOS side, that's fine, easy to do it, but is there any official document in place for sharing classified information between NATO and EU? Thank you, sir.
Very valid question. And I may answer you that already through the exchange of letters in 2003, when I was in Brussels first time, where NATO Secretary Solana swapped over to High Representative of the European Union, High Representative, and he shared the security agreement between NATO and the European Union that was established in 2003. Many have forgotten about it. It's still existing, it's still valid. It doesn't cover the European Defense Agency and it doesn't cover the European Parliament. But we can share classified information between the European Union External Action Service, between the Commission, between the NATO organization. So in principle, technically, it's possible. We have everything in place. If you ask myself, it's a question of willingness. Do you want to share information? And at the end of the day, the Gordic knot, as Sneaky Leaky, the former former Director General of the EU military staff always said, the Gordic knot lies in some capitals of some nations. This means if you want to share information, it's possible. We have a security agreement. You can share what you want between the two organizations. If we get a no, usually it is by one of the nations that says, no, we don't want to share that one. And that brings me to my comparison with the schism of the religions, where you have firm believers and high priests that do not want to share. But it's not a question of possibility. Everything that is from a practitioner's point of view necessary is existence, has been existing since 2003. This means for 18 years now.
And now I have to cut it short because the coffee is getting cold and the coffee is to be drunk hot. So, sir, with due respect, first and foremost, thank you so much for your speech. So, without further ado, before having 20 minutes sharp for the coffee break, because otherwise the pasta at the lunch break will get cold. We cannot eat the cold pasta. I mean, there is some cold pasta. I would like to present you with a coat of arms of the Center of Excellence to thank you for your availability, for your kindness, sir.
Having your
more difficult to work with this mic. By the end of the week I will manage. Colleagues, so we took a little bit more for the break, but I already told the cook to wait for the pasta, because once again we cannot afford to eat the glue. Pasta is to be eaten al dente. You know what is pasta al dente. So there is no translation al dente. So it's to be a little bit tough, not too soft. Not like the glue. So our fellow director, although not NATO, however, is our fellow director from the hybrid COE, Dr. Tia Tikainen, if I'm not mistaken, apologies for my awful pronunciation. The floor is yours. Welcome to Vicenza.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is my true pleasure to be here with you to present my COE, which of course, as was mentioned already by the previous speaker, is not a NATO COE, but however, something that comes very close to the COEs of the NATO, because that has been the model and the structures and ideas of NATO COEs have been copied very much to our hybrid COE. But in this presentation, I will tell you about the focuses of our center, its membership, a little bit about its background, and also try to focus on the work that we are doing in the center that currently has a membership of 33 participating states. The center is open for EU and NATO members for accession, and as it was only established in 2017, we have seen a fast growth of the center in terms of its membership. So our participating states cover NATO allies, most of them EU members, most of them. In November we are happy to receive the 31st participating state, that will be Iceland. Our office is in Helsinki. We have a staff of around 40, a little bit under 40 experts working in Helsinki. Half of them are secondees from the participating states, so that the rest have a contract in Finland. So the hybrid COE, as was nicely presented by the previous speaker, is based on the thinking and ideas that popped up in the immediate aftermath of the Ukraine crisis. It showed that there is a new type of threat conception being used against our Western societies, and that type of threat requires a firm cooperation between the European Union and NATO. We are all vulnerable for threats that take place below the threshold of armed conflict, that use instruments as broad and wide as disinformation, cyber tools, cyber attacks, attacks against critical infrastructures, election interference, and even hybrid warfare with indirect and asymmetric instruments of hybrid warfare being used in war, in theaters such as, of course, Ukraine, but also in Syria, Libya, Nagorno-Karabakh. So we have to address this phenomenon. We have to be aware of our own vulnerabilities in front of it, and that's why we need to pool our forces, share good practices, create capacity and strengthen expertise in the administrations, but also to facilitate cooperation between the European Union and NATO. And these are tasks of the center that I've been leading since the autumn of 2019. So I walk you through my couple of slides to give you a better picture, and at the end I then come back to the organization of my center and the staffing. Can I get the first slide, please? Yes. This is the environment that you all know so well. This is the environment which gives inspiration to the establishment of the hybrid COE. We are in the middle of a power transition in our global environment. It is getting more and more intensive, and it is also a situation where we see new types of power instruments being used, instruments that are somewhat different, even if someone might say that we have seen propaganda, we have seen election interference already during the Cold War times. But the third bullet point here is the new thing. So there is a new technological environment, there is a fast development in our technological environment, including the whole cyber realm, which gives new types of instruments and possibilities, includes new threat potential. If we are not fast enough and identify that potential in order to be able to counter that. So our values are being challenged, the Western-led global order is being challenged. We very much talk about a systemic rivalry between democratic societies and the authoritarian states, but also between the models of democracy and authoritarianism. It's not only that we would be defending our model in our states, that is one thing, but it's also that if we want to keep democracy vital in the world, we have to defend it also outside our states, in all parts of the world where the authoritarian model is gaining support and interest. The fourth point is also important because this is what makes these hybrid threat instruments so useful and interesting from the adversary's point of view. They are very cost efficient. If you think about a cyber attack, if you think about the easiness of using social media tools to interfere in an election and steer decision making in another country, the costs are very low in comparison with the costs of armed force, for instance, or any other traditional tools of power projection. So there are new things around us, a new environment in terms of security policy, and we have to create our capacity and strengthen our understanding of the phenomenon. Next slide, please. This is well known for you. I just picked up some trends that the center has been mapping in our work when we have been following what's going on in the shadow of the pandemic in terms of these threats. Whatever newspaper you open, this is what you always have in the headlines: a cyber attack, a hack and leak operation, cyber tools being used against the critical infrastructure, and this is getting worse and worse. Also, parliaments and governments becoming targets for their information systems, becoming regular targets for cyber attacks. Who's behind this? Is it just some independent groups of hackers, teenagers, or is it a state actor? A state actor that nicely cooperates with proxy actors to weaken, to create instability, to show how vulnerable democratic societies are. In most cases, we don't know. We might guess, we might try to prove, but it is very, very difficult. And psychological pressure here is, of course, the thing. A more long-term hybrid threat instrument takes the form of economic and financial toolbox, takes that form. We see very much from the Chinese point of view, increasing foreign ownership of Western critical infrastructures. In our vocabulary, we talk about priming. Priming, which is more or less a paving the way or preparing for a later operation. What will happen? How will China use later on these critical infrastructures that it owns in Europe and elsewhere? We don't know, but there is, in our view, a huge potential for power projection here, as this has become a typical model of the Chinese activity. Non-state actors, I already mentioned. State actors don't want to be detected or attributed, so that's why they use different companies, groups of individuals, political groups, religious communities to push forward their agenda. We talk about proxy actors. Lawfare is something that we see very much in the South China Sea, we see it in the Arctic, we see it in the maritime environments, where norms of international law are used against their original purpose as political and strategic instruments to give the adversaries the legitimacy and justification for their maritime activities. This is also one of the key focuses of our center. We talk about legal resilience, the need of our societies to make sure that we have a legal framework that supports us against hybrid threats and also gives us the possibility to react. Next slide, please. I'm worried about the clock starting to ring, so I hope I can go to the end of my presentation. Otherwise, the pasta won't be al dente anymore.
No worries. Take your time. It is a golden opportunity for us, so we want to learn from you.
And do you take care of the kitchen then?
I will take care of the cook. So.
Okay.
No, I hope that it's not me, because I'm not a good cook. So.
Okay.
Somebody else taking care of the pasta.
I made three slides to describe to you the focuses of our center, so the content of our work that we are doing in the center. And of course, it's not only in Helsinki in our office, but it's very much as you work as network-based organizations, your COEs, so do we. So we cooperate with the governments of those soon 31 participating states that take part in our activities. Three focal areas for our activity. First, we try to understand these hybrid threats. Understand not in the way of supporting or consenting to them, but understand, try to figure out how they function, what their internal logic is. So because they are different. I mentioned the below the threshold of armed conflict type of character, but they also operate within interfaces between internal and external realms, between peace and war. So they are complicated things, and we have to understand their logic. I mentioned here a couple of projects that we have ongoing. We have been publishing things about deterrence in the hybrid threat context, a playbook. We try to advise our participating states on how we deter these kinds of phenomena. We understand deterrence from its traditional context of nuclear deterrence, for instance, but how do you deter disinformation campaigns? How do you deter cyber attacks? What's the toolbox there? So this is what we have been working on, and we have also put up exercises on that question. Cyber power, there is a specific center in Tallinn, COE, on cyber. So cyber is a topic for us just in this context of hybrid threats, as it's one tool there being used. We are studying that as well. We have been monitoring trends of hybrid threats in various geopolitical realms, the newest of them in the MENA region and in the Arctic. The Arctic report is just to be published, and the Europe's South report was published in July. I should mention that we do a lot of publications on our website, so you should look at our website and publications so you find we do a lot of open publications as increasing awareness of this phenomenon is one part of our work. So it can be, you can find a lot there. Next slide, please. There are some actors behind hybrid threats. We have to understand how this form of activity forms a part of their strategies and policies. We are pretty much focusing, of course, on Russia and China, also on Iran, on non-state actors. How do they see the usefulness of this instrument? In order to be able to prevent and counter that, we try to go into their strategies to be able to put up the right tools. And the third slide, thank you, which is then our vulnerabilities. This is why the center was established. We have to strengthen ourselves, strengthen our response and resolve in front of this phenomenon. And to do that, we need to understand where our vulnerabilities are in terms of critical infrastructure, legal resilience, election interference. Of course, the whole information environment is the key here, how it is being manipulated by the adversaries. And of course, social media platforms play a key role there. We have also a project ongoing where we compare the policies and strategies of our 30 participating states concerning countering hybrid threats and try to pick up the best practices from there to then disseminate them. The next slide, please. This is how we... Some flags are missing still because we just had a new country joining us last week, Belgium, and now Iceland will be the next one. So this is how we function. I think this has been basically copied from NATO COEs. So many thanks to all of you who have constructed that model. We have a steering board, that's the highest executive body of the hybrid COE, bringing together representatives of all the participating states, convening into meetings twice a year, nominating the director. They nominated me. I come from academia. I was the director of the Finnish Institute of International Affairs for 10 years. So I came from that position to this. And then we are down there, we have our communities of interest. So they are the networks. That's our organization. We simply organize our work so that we have hybrid influencing topics related to election interference, disinformation, conceptual work in one community of interest. We have strategy and defense, which is more your field, so hybrid warfare, also cyber there, modern technologies in the hybrid threat realm in the second community of interest, and then these vulnerabilities and resilience in the third. We have a small research and analysis component supporting our work. It's not so small anymore. Seven experts, academic experts also involved there. And we have a training and exercises component led by a US military female expert with military background in charge of our trainings and exercises. And then we have the administration. And the final slide, please. No, okay, something was missing. I lost one picture. So we are, as mentioned, we are around 40 experts in the Helsinki-based office, but these networks are much, much broader. So we have some 2,000 names in our network. So when we send whatever material we want, we use those lists. So there is a lot of engagement from the administrations and also from academia in our participating states. Finland is the host country and provides half of our core budget being a little bit under 4 million euros annually. We do cooperate with many centers of excellence. You many of you have cooperated with us in the framework of trainings and exercises, in the frameworks of joint projects. I'm very thankful for that and look forward to further cooperation with you. I want to thank for this opportunity to present my center. Thank you so much. And of thank you. I don't know if there is time for questions, but if there, I will be happy to address, but perhaps I use that.
Is there any questions?
Yes.
Wait, 1 second, the microphone, 1 second. Tisha, somebody will take care of you at lunchtime, because my fellow deputy director and the chief of staff of the center, of my center of excellence, will take you as a host, so they will bombard you with other questions, because as a stability policing subject matter expert, we are very interested
on
your center. So
yes, I will be happy to talk.
Likewise.
It looks as I've got the chance to ask the question, but I will start with a kind of statement, afterwards question will follow. I'm Kanaush Kuraitis, coming from NATO Energy Security Center of Excellence. And first part will go to compliment your center, who is working with us, especially in the area of exercise. We just conducted together with four another centers exercise in Ukraine, which has been seen by participants and different institutions as kind of very good fusion of the knowledge, even though you are not NATO Center of Excellence, but when it goes to cooperation there, nobody was asking to whom you belong to. We were asking, can you help us, and you helped a lot. My question will be related to the hybrid asymmetric terminology. As I'm coming from NATO, and AJP1 has definitions or tries to define the hybrid and separately asymmetric threat. In our center, we are also looking at some kind of environment we would squeeze in our knowledge, and we have some difficulties. You were referring even to the cyber as instrument. So can I assume that you, when it goes to ends, ways, and means, hybrid is seen as the way how the opponent shapes the operating environment. This is nothing phenomenal. This is the way. Thank you.
Well, it's a huge question, of course. I think a hybrid threats toolbox can be utilized in many different manners by the adversaries. I think if we think about the strategic level and not the operational level, if we think about the strategic level, the key goal of hybrid threat activity is to prevent the target from being prepared. So if they would use these traditional means, there would be a preparedness, there would be capabilities, there would be policies, there would be a preparedness to counter, to respond, and also retaliate, punish activity. But when the toolbox is different, when it includes surprises, I think the key strategic goal is to surprise the target so that the target is not prepared, does not have the policies. This is what is our key challenge. But of course, if you think about the operational level, and then it's certainly how you described it. To affect the environment. When we talk about hybrid warfare, we of course the whole discussion started from the asymmetric hybrid warfare being a form of asymmetric warfare. So this is a little bit different discussion. But interesting questions. I'd be happy to talk to you over lunch or whenever. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much to you once again. Now is the time for the CMRE Deputy Director, Dr. Giovanni Sembenini. Please, the floor is yours. We can afford 25 minutes, if you don't mind. And being Italian, you know that pasta is to be al dente. So does it suit to you, or do you need some extra time after the break?
My professor back in PhD school always warned me at the conference, never stand between the audience and lunch, nor between the audience and the coffee break.
Indeed.
So I will be fast and furious.
It's better quick and dirty.
Or quick and dirty.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Can you hear me? Can you understand me? Okay, we're in business.
We are not in BTC.
just the mindset. Real people in a real environment. Good to be here. So, first of all, director, general, distinguished guest and participant, good morning. Thank you for inviting us, first of all. We're very glad to be here. And it's a pleasure to be here physically with you. I also bring you the greetings and the congratulations for the event from Dr. Catherine Warner, the director of the CMRE, who unfortunately could not join us here today. I personally want to thank you, the organizers, for the great work and the great efforts. We do organize events, so I know how much blood you have to shed to get everybody physically together. So thank you. I'll briefly walk you through what the CMRE is today. Please allow me to skip our more than 60 years old history. Some of you might remember us from previous names, SACLANT or NERC. Now we're called CMRE, Center for Maritime Research and Experimentation. By the way, we are located in lovely La Spezia. And I'll take this opportunity to invite you all, maybe some of you have already done it, to invite you all to come visit us, to enjoy the venue, and to discuss how to engage together and make our collective contribution to the nations and the alliance ever more valuable. Next, please. And there you can see a picture of where we are. So, briefly speaking, the CMRE conducts and organizes scientific research and technology development. The two souls of the centers work together seamlessly as our scientists think about solutions, think about future science, and then we connect with engineers and the experimenters that we have in-house to actually deploy this science and technology solutions. Solutions that address all the needs of the Alliance and the nations, and we've done that for more than 60 years, as I said. Next, please. So, at the core, there is a set of world-class scientists and engineers, people working in S&T day in and day out. We're an unbiased hub. We deliver S&T for the nations, NATO, and the partners, and we work a lot with partners. We develop basically what we can call game-changing solutions in the domains that we'll see later on in my presentation. We're also encased in a rich network and collaborative environment with many other entities and institutions. And I'll briefly touch upon that at the end of my presentation. So we are operationally relevant. This is a key word. We're operationally relevant as we deploy into exercises. Next, please. And we deploy with this. Mainly, we deploy with our two naval assets. These are NATO-owned assets, two ships, one called NATO Research Vessel Alliance on the left-hand side of the slide, the other one, Coastal Research Vessel Leonardo. You can see the features there on the slide. They are owned by NATO, under custody of the center, and currently flagged and manned by a permanent crew of the Italian Navy. Next, please. Talking about assets, a few words about our robotic assets. Given that the center has developed over the years, especially over the recent years, a hardcore knowledge about autonomy, and we develop autonomy in support of various missions, we have acquired a fleet of robotic assets. We do have surface vehicles, and we have underwater vehicles. This will be particularly valuable in the context of the up and coming, hopefully soon to be tested in real world, DIANA, the Defense Innovation Accelerator for the North Atlantic, for the test part. Next, please. So, where are we? Senator Pucciarelli mentioned earlier the, so let me fly a little bit higher than what I've written here on the slide, NATO 2030. That is basically the guiding light for us, or as the center mentioned, the compelling compass for what we do and the direction where we go. From there, we crumble down to the overall emerging and disruptive technology list for NATO. And if I understood correctly, Mr. Ziegler already mentioned that and touched upon a few of the key issues, which for us are working on EDTs and bridging over to developing capabilities for the warfighter. As of today, our program of work is mainly centered around these focus areas. Autonomy for anti-submarine warfare, autonomous system for mine countermeasures, naval mine countermeasures, even if we have a solid tradition of working in amphibious operation and coastal area, especially for the protection of critical infrastructure. The so-called ECOE, or Environmental Knowledge and Operational Effectiveness, or Maritime ISR program of work. The Data Knowledge and Operational Effectiveness, or Maritime Situational Awareness, part of the program of work. And the so-called Maritime Enablers. Next, please. So, starting from the anti-submarine warfare, this is basically the soul, the ancient soul of the center. This is the main reason why we were stood up more than 60 years ago, but it has come to surface, using a submarine term, very relevantly recently with the so-called third battle of the Atlantic. And we know that with the development of new technologies in submarine propulsion and sensors and so on, anti-submarine warfare is now more important than ever. To protect our sea routes, as we know well, the Alliance members might not all be seafaring and coastal nations, but almost all goods being shipped across the world travel by sea lanes, and so that also impacts landlocked nations. So, in brief, the ESW program work focuses on maritime unmanned systems for ESW. We do not build in-house the systems that you have seen in the previous slide and that you can see in the middle figure there, yellow and orange being deployed. We buy commercial system, we gut them out completely, and we have the capability in-house to think, design, and realize payloads, power system, control systems, and artificial intelligence add-on to these autonomous systems. We work on decision support in these focus areas, decision to the commander in the field, decision to the people deployed in the field who need to understand what's going on and how to act. So closing the OODA loop as fast as possible. The benefits, of course, are that these unmanned systems are a force multiplier for the traditional platforms. We perform missions without air superiority or in contested water, and we deliver the capability for less money. Of course, we know how tight our budgets are these days. Next, please. The autonomous naval mine countermeasure part of the program work is very similar to ASW, but more concerned with underwater mines. Let me digress a second here. One part that is unfortunately coming up in a very relevant way recently that have been a little bit, I don't want to say forgotten, but less brought to our attention is the unexploded ordnance underwater. We recently participated in an event in Kiel, and we are setting up an UXO, unexploded ordnance, test range dedicated to the cleaning of the undersea unexploded ordnance. Especially some seas surrounding the Alliance are particularly polluted with unexploded ordnance and other items that need to be recovered and neutralized as soon as possible, notwithstanding the risk of having dead seas around us. Next, please. Okay, so this is the crown slide. Crown slide because thank you to all the speakers, most of the speakers who came before me, starting from Senator Pucciarelli and General Cole, who I don't see. Okay, thank you, I got lights in my eyes. Climate change. We are lucky enough to have at the center two things: long experience in what used to be called military oceanography, and now environment, and then climate change. And we're lucky enough to have Dr. Sandro Carniel, who's here with us today from the center, who is a world-class renowned oceanographer who has been able to support in the context of NATO 2030, and especially recently following last June summit declaration, has been supporting the Office of the Chief Scientist with several reports on climate change, prepared based on his personal experience and the experience that the center has, not simply to depict what climate change is doing to our operational environment, but also to hint at solutions that when, I don't say if, when nations will agree to come together, would be actionable, it would be actionable knowledge to prevent or to correct or to support security challenges to our forces, to our nations, stemming from climate change. Allow me just two more words on this. Climate change is important for all of us in our daily life, but for all of us here, climate change is particularly important for the effects it has on the security environment and the effect it has on our operations. We need to understand what are these changes, not simply because we need to hunt submarines in a previously inaccessible environment. Doctor, sorry, I might got your name wrong, Tiilikainen previously mentioned the Arctic. Well, I didn't spoke with Dr. Tiilikainen before, but look at the two pictures up there, the Arctic. We, last week, in the context of the Sea Future in Rome, we had a dedicated session because, like over the past few years, this past summer, we had a mission called High North, where Alliance, our ship, carried out, over the course of more than a month, dedicated experiments and surveys in the areas between Greenland and the Svalbard archipelago. As I said, the ice is melting, the polar caps are retreating. This means opening new highways for submarines, opening new highways for maritime convoys, and changing the physics features of how sounds propagate, or how the rules, the traditional rules for hunting submarines for situational awareness are. But as I said, Dr. Tarniel will be glad to provide you a more scientific explanation to this. So this is what we do. Next, please. And then we come to data knowledge and operational effectiveness, which is a vast pool of knowledge that we have created and we leverage. And once again, just to cut short here, sorry, but I'll be able to answer your questions later. If you look at the focus areas, the second item is anomaly detection. This allows me to reconnect to an area that we are exploring with private companies very recently because of the importance of undersea infrastructure. Sorry to chime in again on the previous presentation, but we all know traditionally, oil and gas, the pipelines, and so on and so forth. But look at your cell phone and think, where do the data from the internet in your cell phone come from in the physical world? Underwater cables. Underwater cables are all over, and right now are the real bottleneck and the real key security issue in the global internet. We all know how some nations have dedicated vessels and dedicated underwater system that I don't want to say can tamper with our cables, but for sure can over around the area of our cables, understanding what's going on, and so on and so forth. Next, please. The last part is the maritime enablers. In here, we have basically interoperability, which is a key word in NATO environment, modeling and simulation. And we already cooperate with the Modeling and Simulation Center of Excellence in Rome, our good friends, and underwater communication. Underwater communication, of course, is key now more than ever, given that we have increasing traffic, increasing deployments, and increasing issues of interoperability between different forces. Next, please. Just a quick glance, these are all some of the EDTs that we all know, and just to remind you all how we're working on it. Next, please. Of course, we did our best to support our countries with the response to COVID. We were lucky enough, thank you to the director, to stay safe, but at the same time, we were lucky enough to have a long-standing history of data analysis, and so we were called into play by many of our nations to support them with the forecast of how the COVID situation would evolve. Next, please. Collaboration opportunities, that's why we are here. Again, thank you for inviting us, because we do believe in cooperation between the center and our center and the centers of excellence. We do a substantial story of collaboration, not overly long, but substantial, especially with the naval mine warfare center of excellence, the confined shallow water center of excellence. We have already engaged with the new GeoMeetok in Portugal, because we have previous connections, and Joint Ops from the Sea also is on our list of corporations. The up and coming, hopefully soon, Center of Excellence on Climate Change, we have already engaged with the One Nation, NATO Nations, who has proposed herself, for hosting the Center of Excellence, and so we are willing and we're already cooperating with them. Just a few final words to stay within the time allotted. We are very similar. The CMRE is very similar to the Center of Excellence in the sense that we have great brain power, like you all do. We are no cost for NATO, in the sense that, unfortunately, unbeknownst to most of us, I have to say, the center is fully customer funded. Since 2012, the center does not receive any common funding. And so we are basically on par with you in terms of financial sustainment. We conform to all NATO procedures, of course, as you do. We have a strong relationship with the Strategic Command, especially with our good friends and former family, ACT. And we are still interlocked, joined by the EAP, with the ACT. We can support you. We can work along with you in any one of the four pillars that make up the core of the Centers of Excellence: education and training. As a matter of fact, one of the scientists working for Sandro Carniel is going to support the Security Center of Excellence for a course coming up soon, training course. Analysis and lessons learned, that's what we do every time we either support operations or exercises, Dynamic Manta, Dynamic Mariner, and so on and so forth. Concept development and experimentation, we are engaging with the unit in ACT so to ensure that we can play a relevant role for you, ACT. And we stand ready to support you in any doctrine development you would like to bring forward in any of the areas that we are strong in. And that's it. Thank you, and I'll be glad to take any questions now or after lunch.
Thank you, Dr. Sembrini. Is there any... When the clock is ticking, it's very tight, isn't it? So, is there any question? We'll not kill you, because pasta is waiting, but... Okay, so the spouses will join us for lunch. So we will convene
15 minutes later, instead of 1:30, 1:45, so we have some more time to stretch our legs and to enjoy the lunch. But please be sharp, be on time. So 13:45, 1:45, the hour, shall see you here for the second phase. Thank you so much, Dr. Sambenini.
Thank you, Director.
You can leave everything, provided that there is nothing suspicious. Otherwise, Yo-Yo, the Country ID Center of Excellence Director, will look into it. I shall see you downstairs. Mi hanno fatto notare che non ho ringraziato, non ho salutato Gianni Paparella quando ho fatto... Grazie.